Are you sick of struggling, trying to figure out what the right tool is for the right job? Are you there straining, hurting yourself, stressing and worrying about trying to get the job done in the most efficient way possible? Well, we've got the solution for you. Meet CodeServer. CodeServer is designed to run in your browser and give you easy access to edit all your config, code, and any other server-based files directly in your browser from anywhere in the world. No more needing to go through the terminal. No more needing to worry about whether permissions are there, whether you can get access to the files on the server. In fact, you don't even need something like Nextcloud to help you get the job done. Ni hao, Ibra Army, and welcome back to another IBRACORP video. Thank you for tuning in with us today. As usual, it's a pleasure to have you here. And judging by our intro, we're going to be going with CodeServer today. We're going to show you this nifty tool that's going to help you manage all your configuration and code remotely. And it's going to be able to run directly on your server, and you can run it in any browser. This will tie in perfectly to a future video where we're going to do the Ultimate Authelia Guide for 2022. So if you're interested in that video, make sure you subscribe so you get notified once we put it up. But just quickly, so what is CodeServer? The highlights are code on any device with a consistent development environment, use cloud servers to speed up tests, compilations, downloads, and more, and preserve battery life when you're on the go. All the intensive tasks run on your server. Coder works with the tools that you work with, so there's no need to change your preferred editor, CI tooling, or version control system. You'll be able to speed up your builds and tests. You can use the power and scale of the cloud to offload the burden of slow builds and test your local machine. You can develop with any device. Just access the workspace from anywhere with the same snappy development experience that you expect from a local IDE. You can onboard to new projects from whenever and wherever you are. Onboard to a new project can take days away from your productivity and hinders collaboration. Get on the same page and stay on the same page faster. Secure your data and source code. Source code and data can remain secured in the cluster or in authorized repos, not sitting on a workstation or laptop. So guys, those were the words from the developer, and Coder is a useful tool. It's a really, really cool tool because it's going to allow you to edit stuff commonly need a text editor for, or something like Notepad++. Then you're worrying about permissions and trying to get everything working that way. So we're going to show you how to install it using Docker, and today we're going to be using the example on Unraid, but the same principle applies to anywhere else that you use Docker as well. Alternatively, on the GitHub page, you can find all their information in terms of getting started with just a script, and you can run it that way as well. It's also really beneficial for you to think about how you want to deploy CodeServer, because you can deploy CodeServer at your server at home, you can deploy it if you have a server in the cloud, and it's going to allow you to access your files and manage stuff so much easier. We can also install extensions which will allow us to validate our content and code. For example, YAML configuration, especially when we're using Authelia or any other YAML-based configuration file, the validator will be able to actually find extra spaces or incorrect characters, or whatever the case might be, to help you troubleshoot your issues faster. And since we're all about modern problems and modern solutions, we think this is definitely one for you. So if you're interested, stick around and let's get stuck into it. So guys, welcome back to another video this week. Absolute pleasure to have you here. And today, like I said, we're going to be looking at Coder. So we're looking at Coder. Here is their repository, the original Coder/CodeServer. And if we scroll down, it's got a whole bunch of information for us to absorb and read. Now, the main page is pretty brief. There's not too much that needs to go on. But if we go to coder.com, then you'll get a little bit more information in terms of their documentation and all the other sort of information that you might find relevant. So I highly recommend you guys check out the official docs for this one, and we'll see that you've got a whole bunch of different ways that you can deploy Coder to get the job done. Now, if you've never seen it before, you might be wondering, well, you know, what does it look like? How does it work? We're going to get straight into the install, and then I'm going to show you how to use it. And we'll also add a couple of extensions, like the YAML extension as well, so that we can have the best sort of environment where we can edit stuff directly in our browser. So let's get stuck into the install and let's see how we go from there. As usual, we've signed into Unraid and we're sitting in the App Store at this point in time. If you're using an operating system that isn't Unraid, that's perfectly fine. It's still just running Docker. So we'll show you the Docker image that we're using, and then you can go ahead and use it as well. So in the search bar, let's type code server. Now you see various different options. Today we're going to go with Linux servers repositories version. So code-server is the one that we want to use. So big shout out to the Linux server team. Thank you very much for your awesome work continually making these images for us to use. Just give them props. If you want to help support their work, be sure to head over to linuxserver.io and support them any way you can. You've also got the support button here if you're on Unraid so that you can follow it through and help support them that way. So we're going to go with code server. Let's click on it and we'll go to install, and we're going to get asked which branch that we want to install. So we're going to go ahead and click default, and now you'll see we land on the configuration page. Again, if you're following this in terms of just a normal Docker deployment, these are your variables that are already configured in a template here in Unraid, but in your case, you would put them in your either Docker run command or your Docker compose file. So be sure to refer to the official docs on how you want that deployed, especially the Linux server ones. They do have their own docs for this as well. So with the main configuration page open, we're going to start looking through. So the first thing we're going to do is probably pick our internal network. So let's pick our custom Docker network there. We have a video on that if you don't know about it, so be sure to check that out. For the web UI, the default port is 8443. Now, unless you need to change it, leave it as is. If you're not sure whether it's taken, we'll drop down Docker allocations here, and then we can basically just do a control F, 8443, and I don't have that taken, so that should be fine. So let's leave 8443 as our port. Now, there's a few passwords that we are asked to configure. The first password is the optional web GUI password. Now, at this point is where I will interject and say, if you have followed our Authelia documentation and you have Authelia working on all your other applications, this is the perfect scenario to put Authelia over the top so that you can protect Code Server. It is really, really important that you guys make this particular app very secure. As you can imagine, it's going to have access to your file server. It's going to have access to your files and your code. So we want to make sure that that's safe. In order to do that, apply Authelia over the top. Even if you did set a password here in the GUI, I would still put Authelia over the top. So I can't reiterate that enough. Please make sure that you make it secure in order to protect yourself and protect your system from vulnerabilities. But the first password is pretty simple. So we've got optional GUI password. If password or hash password is not provided, there will be no auth. So I'm going to put a password in there and we'll just go with something that works for us. You then got the hash password. So as it says here, if you configure this, it will override this field. Okay, and instructions on how to do this are below. Then we have the sudo password. If it's set, user will have sudo access in the code server terminal with the specified password. So let's set a sudo password. And do we want that hashed as well? So we've got the option to hash that as well if required. Then you've got proxy domain. If this optional variable is set, the domain will be proxied for subdomain proxy. So in this field, we'll put something like code.ibracorp.io. That's in my case. If yours is going to be something else, obviously make it relevant to yourself. Then have the default workspace. So what's our default workspace to show up when we open it up? If it's set, code server will open this directory by default. And currently that's configured to /config/workspace. So where's config? Let's go to edit under the app data location. And we can see that the container path config is referring to our app data location here on code server. So it's basically going to be app data code server /workspace. That's going to be the default one that opens. So what we can do to add to this is actually add a additional path to allow us to access any of the shares that we want whenever we want. So we'll go to add another path port or variable. So in here, we're going to put in a path called array. So I've just given it the name array. We've got the container path to /array. So the reason why we do that is inside the container, then it will see something called array. You can rename it to whatever you like. That just makes sense to us. So we're going to use that. For the host path, where we want that map to from the container to our host, I've told it to just look at the very top level in Unraid, which is MNT. If you don't want that, if you feel like that's a bit too risky for you and you only want it to look in a specific location, then by all means, instead of MNT, go down a little further. Break down the list, go down into user, for example. You can go to user, you can go to updater, whatever the case might be. So in our case, we can just put updater if we wanted to. And then in that case, I'd probably call it updater. All right, but I want everything to come through in there because I want to be able to access everything on the server remotely. So I'm going to leave it at the very top level, which is MNT. So now that we've left the MNT, the default value we don't need to change, and the access mode is read-write, that's perfectly fine. If you want to put a description in there, you can. Go ahead and click add. All right, for those following along with a Docker compose or Docker run command, obviously the principle applies, just map it to wherever you need to map it to. We then have app data, so we've got our path, and we've also got our extra array path here mapped as well. That's pretty much it, guys. So once we're done, go ahead and click apply. Now back in our Docker tab, we can see code server is running and it's ready to go. And I've gone and put it in our file management Docker folder that we've created. I get asked quite a lot, guys, if you're interested in how we got this to look this way and have these Docker folders. We literally have a video called Docker folders on our channel. So be sure to check that out and it'll help you get that set up for yourself. So from this point, we can now run it. So let's click on it, click web UI, and then we're going to be confronted with the password that we configured. Perfectly fine. Let's try that out. Now let's absorb what we're seeing here for a moment. You saw a little warning come up there. That warning basically said we're being accessed over an insecure domain. That's fine. And the reason is we are accessing it locally, so it's not a secure domain. Once we reverse proxy it, that message should no longer be there. So let's clear the notification. That's fine. So we're in this first page. It's going to give you a couple of things to help you get started, which is fantastic. First thing we'll do is change the theme, because I know, at least for me, I absolutely can't stand white themes anymore. I don't know what's happened to my eyes, but I just can't go back to them. So in here, we've got dark, we've got default dark, you got Kimby dark. You've got all sorts of themes, which is really, really nice. We're going to go with dark Visual Studio. You guys watching this in the dark should appreciate it a little bit more. So with the theme set, you can pretty much stop there, but you've got the whole thing that you can go through if you wanted to, so that you can keep customizing things with the way we want. So for example, we've got the command palette there. If you wanted to change some key bindings to help you manage things a little bit easier, you can definitely remap stuff the way you want. You've then got the menu bar if you want to toggle that, if you want language support and extensions, and then if you want to quickly open a file. So the next thing we want to do is open up a folder and start navigating to what we need. So in the top here, we'll go to the menu bar, go to file, and go open folder. Now, as you can see, the default thing it's showing us is that config folder, which is the app data folder for code server. There's nothing really in there that we want to change. So what we'll do is click the dots to go back, and you'll see array here. Now array is what we mapped in the Docker container template. If you named it something else, it'll be under that name that you gave it, but we're gonna go with array. And then we've got all the stuff underneath that. So then if you go to user and app data, for example, we can click okay. And here's our app data folder ready to go. So let's look at something like Orthelia, for example. Click on configuration YAML. And as you can see, we have access to this configuration file from anywhere in the world through our browser. We don't have to go through the file server. We don't have to go through something like Nextcloud. We don't have to worry about SMB shares, none of that. It's all directly in the browser for us. The beauty of it is, if we start typing stuff and we make changes to the file and we get out of it and we go something like here and then we come back, the file's already saved as we go along. As you can see, we also opened the file, which opened up a new tab. So then we can switch between files really, really easily, helping us get that workflow and working really, really fast. So that's something that's really good. So I might just take that out. Doesn't matter anyway, it's commented, but that's the first part of it. Now on the side here, you can see you've got this awesome little thing here to scroll up and down through the file and help you find stuff a lot quicker. If you guys have used Visual Studio before on your desktop, you'll feel a bit familiar with it. If you're completely new, then you know, obviously I'm showing you a couple of things just to help you get started. In the top here, you've also got the split editor. So if we click the split editor, you can have two side by side so that you can work along two different files and follow them along. So maybe you've got a template for the configuration and you wanna just compare it to, you know, the new one. You can do that as well. So that's opening and editing the file. That's how easy that is. It's so simple. But code server can be changed and added to so that you can really increase your productivity where possible. So we'll keep following down the list here on the side. In the manage icon, the little cog icon here, we'll click that. And then you've got a whole bunch of settings that you can go back to. So if we go to settings, for example, we can change the font size, the tab size, you know, white space if you want to render it, word wrapping, how you want it to behave with extended sentencing. You've got your text editing settings. You can basically customize everything, and it'll really help you navigate and use the application in all sorts of different areas. We've then also got the workbench, you've got the window, any other features you want to add. There's obviously so much here that if we were going to go through every single option, guys, we'll be here all week. But so help yourself, make sure you go in and just have a look around, poke around, see what settings there are, because there's usually stuff in there that will make your life really, really easy. The next section we're going to talk about is extensions. So in here, you've got some extensions already, but if we want to add some in the left-hand side here, or using Control Shift X extensions, and it's going to bring up a sort of app store, and it's going to show you what's popular. So here's all these different popular ones that you don't already have them. One that we always use quite often these days is YAML. So why don't we install the YAML extension? Click of a button, we can install that. And then back in our settings that we were in before, we've got our YAML settings there, and we can go through and basically work through all the settings for that the way we want. If we go back to the Explorer and I click on Authelia configuration, so what we'll do is purposely put an extra space. So let's say here in front of refresh interval, if we just put an extra space here, automatically, straight away, we haven't had to do anything, we'll see this red marker come up, and we'll see that the file also turns red, and in the tab it's red as well. Immediately it's telling us that there's a formatting issue. So if we just hover our mouse over this, all mapping items must start at the same column. So it immediately tells us something's off here. As soon as I backspace it, it validates. Happy days, you know that something looks right. So in the event that, you know, for example here, that we've added an extra two spaces here, we're trying to figure out where the issue is, straight away it just reads it for us and tells us it's somewhere here. So as you scroll down the file, the rest of these are gonna be wrong because they're not in the same configuration anymore. So if we scroll up, you can usually pinpoint now, okay, from this point on, something's broken. Here it is right here, if I backspace that, too far, it's wrong as well, just enough, and it validates. So a really, really useful extension for you guys, especially when you're following our documentation on something like Authelia, it's gonna make your life so much easier. So I highly recommend that extension. And pretty much the last thing I wanna show you guys today is the ability for you to manage your source code and have it so that code server directly talks to your repositories and publishing it to GitHub, so that way, you can code stuff in your GitHub directly in Code Server, so you don't even have to go to GitHub to do it. So in here under source control, if we click on that, you're presented with two options. So you've got initialize repository and you've got publish to GitHub. So what this will do is the current folder that's open, it doesn't have a Git repository. By initializing it, you'll initialize a repository which will enable source control features powered by Git. You can also directly publish this folder to a GitHub repository. So the times where you create, you know, in our scenario, we create Unraid templates, Unraid container templates. We could actually just use it here, create the folder, and then just publish it directly to GitHub. If you're using a laptop, if you're using some sort of device, you want to be able to edit the files, but you don't want to store the files on your laptop, and you want to have it consistently accessible no matter where you are, this is going to be the perfect solution, guys. So guys, that's Code Server. I hope you enjoyed that. It's a super easy thing to set up and use. The last thing I would suggest you guys do is reverse proxy it out so that you can get full functionality. There is limited functionality in certain things, or they may not behave that well in an unsecure environment. So reverse proxying it, give it that certificate, access it from a secure domain, and then apply Authelia over the top. If you haven't watched our Nginx Proxy Manager, Cloudflare, or Authelia videos, I highly suggest you go check those out on our channel. This tool will help you go into those a little bit easier and help you manage your configuration as you go along. If we missed any features or any important tooltips that you want to share with other people who are watching the video, be sure to let us know in the comments below or join us in our Discord and have a chat with the community. We'd love to see you there. It's a new year here at IBRACORP 2022, and we can't wait to keep pushing out some more content for you. If you want to help support the channel, please check the links below. Any way that you choose to support us is appreciated. Remember to like and subscribe. It really helps YouTube get us out there and show people that we've got some content they might be interested in. Thank you to all of our loyal fans. We really appreciate you, and we'll see you in the next IBRACORP video.